Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byf here. So, first proper lore video of the season and of the expansion. Sorry it took so long. I had to do a lot of reading around this stuff, and getting things generally organized in my head was one thing, but beyond all of just that, I needed to make sure I didn't burn out, as I mentioned on Twitter. So, yeah. Today we are starting. However, I wanted to start with a series of videos where we're going to touch on the story of one of the most important characters in Beyond Light's lore and possibly in all of Destiny. I am of course referring to the egomaniacal, cold genius that was Clovis Bray I. So where do we even begin? But of course, at the beginning. Back before Beyond Light, we knew only whispers and small fragments of lore surrounding Clovis Bray, both the man and the corporation. The one thing that seems really clearly hinted at is that Clovis Bray had little to no scruples. That theme is fully realized now with the new lore, but to understand any of it, you need to know definitively where it started. Clovis Bray was a genius, and needless to say, a genius in the Golden Age would flourish. Clovis Bray did just this, and being the humble guy that he was, built a massive megacorporation and named it after himself. Yes, the Clovis Bray Corporation. It worked to advance sciences and industries of humanity, but generally it's also known, or well, best known in these days, for creating some of the more magnificent wonders of the Golden Age. Siva was an invention of the corporation. Rasputin was an invention of the corporation. The Exos were an invention of the corporation. There's even a hint that one of the Brays might have made early leaps that served as the foundations for engram technology, although I'd need to read that again just to double check. I know that it was mentioned somewhere in the journals. Bungie has worked for a long time to present Clovis Bray as this endless house of wonders that just spewed out great invention after great invention, but they've also worked just as long to show that these wonders were gifted to the world at a real human cost, which is not so loudly spoken about. The best example of this is the development of early Siva nanites, which were overseen by one of Clovis Bray's grandchildren, Wilhelmina, or Willa. The project was run by a Dr. Shirazi, and she would eventually quit based on what was frankly moral repugnance to what she had done. I won't go into the full point of the story because I've actually covered this one a whole lot in the past. I believe I have an entire video talking about it somewhere way back when. I think it might actually be at the end of the Season of the Worthy where I talked about the Siva trials, but regardless, the trials conducted with Siva had terrifying results for the participants, and the trials themselves ignored a lot of robust ethical protocols so as to allow them to proceed more quickly. They were conducted in parallel, for example, meaning that if one subject went wrong, they couldn't later edit the tests based on the errors that had been made in any first failed subject, because they were all the first subjects. If one of them failed, then everyone was learning about it fresh and they wouldn't have time to synthesize a solution or try and come up with a hypothesis as to what went wrong. They would just have to deal with it on the fly. Now this of course is just a small insight into the real depths of amorality that were displayed by Clovis Bray, both the corporation and the person, and it's not to say that it was universally the case throughout the company. However, it is to say that the Brays as a family flirt with danger and had a general disregard towards their fellow humans on a regular basis. And this is true to an extent of all the Brays, but none more so than the grandfather and patriarch of the lineage, Clovis Bray I. There are most definitely those that buck the trends. His three granddaughters, Wilhelmina, Anna, and Elsie, most certainly did buck that trend a lot, but even they have moments in their story where they fall back slightly into the tendencies of Clovis Bray's original kind of disregard for humanity for the sake of the greater good. You could even say that to an extent, Elsie portrays this with the very idea that she wants to wield stasis for good, a power of literal darkness. It's possibly the case that she is one of the only people that could have ever come to this conclusion based purely on her past. It's a very interesting idea, but regardless, it's not why we're here today. To understand how all of Clovis Bray's story in Beyond Light really starts though, we need to not initially head out to the icy moon of Europa, but instead to the moon. It's here that the Clovis Bray Corporation partnered with the Chinese Aerospace Authority to form the K-1 mission, under the guise of simple extra New Light personnel at the New Light Mass Driver system. This mission, however, was something different. It was a group of scientists, aerospace military personnel, and others who had an interest in studying a mysterious object. This object had been recovered from below the depths of the lunar surface and was an impossibly dense black sphere that the team would come to know as the Anomaly. This was inspected by Alton Bray at a certain point, and it appears clear from early readings of Clovis Bray's journal that he too visited the site or was influenced by it to some small extent. It's from here that I'll start our dive into the journals of Clovis Bray, and with that we can reveal where all of this really goes. It's worth noting that these journals were kept electronically by an artificial intelligence known as Hanutu, which I believe inhabited the ship that Clovis Bray arrived on Europa from. Clovis Bray's AI, of course, is not the main writer, it's Clovis Bray himself, but even at later dates, I believe Clovis Bray goes back and creates notes on his journal. It's mostly clear that it seems to be him, but it's not completely confirmed. Keep in mind as well that all of these journal entries are from the Collector's Edition Clovis Bray Journal that you can get if you ordered the Collector's Edition from Bungie. However, there is a digital copy available online. If someone wants me to go ahead and link that transcript, I can go ahead and do that for you, and it will be down below in the description. Regardless, so it begins. Entry 1. A new start. A clean page for a most important story. Hanutu is aerobraking around Jupiter. The Lord of Planets thunders his greeting to me. As I record this, I am blasting Evanti 3's Siegfried in the Storm Wall over the radio howl of the Jovian magnetosphere. It galvanizes me. I am with the gods. Ask Avanti's trainers how they settled on the 1-2-3 suffixes. Numbers are perfectly defined, therefore inhuman. Is this suffix meant to mark the Avanti AI as non-human? Objective: construct long-term scientific outpost for study of indigenous European life. Resources: 8 prefab starter habitats, 600 shielded heavy work frames, and this brackets new and B-RA/MA cytomachines with backup replication chambers aboard Hanu. The best hazardous environment engineers money can't buy. Smile support for extended duration. 2 of Elizabeth's Eon-type platforms for radar, LiDAR, and deep ice mapping. Hazards: lethal radiation environment. Heavy ion bombardment from Jovian magnetosphere. Unshielded crew half-life is 24 hours. The most expensive lie in human history. I am not here for a safari. All of Europa's life will soon be known, mapped, and exhausted of wonder, bound by the tedious constraints of physics and biology. I know these things too well. They are already killing me. The K-1 artifact promised me an offering, a gateway to the secret of immortality. I call it Clarity. It is waiting on Europa. I am still dying, but not fast enough to kill me. Corporeal status: body at 35.9 degrees Celsius, pulse 25 beats per minute, strength good, BP 75 over 50, respiration 6 breaths per minute, pulse OX 210%. Today's blood mix is perfluorocarbon with stem slurry. Avoid hyperfocus with alpha wave brainwash for 10 minutes per hour. New kidneys are growing in Whitford, the Delhi pig, for next transplants. Must find a good pork recipe so Whitford will not go to waste. Medical team insists I accept cytomachine injections. No, nothing enters my body that does not share my genetic self-interest. Instead, I will grow an upgraded monocyte strain. Elizabeth's birthday approaches. A good gift would be an olive branch. Never let her say I do not try. Hanu, please identify a gift that could only come from my own intimate and personal knowledge of my granddaughter. Gift suggestions: antique weapon or twin eagle replica. professional pilot trained on Eon Series ship, bespoke AI writer of personalized novels, Fruit Basket, Titan Farmed, humanitarian investment, minefield clearance, long-term reparations, anti-traumatic medicine. These are pathetic. Anu? Revised gift suggestions. Research endowment. Medical. Prion disease in persons with immune resistance to recombinant gene therapy. Research endowment. Medical. Sporadic fatal insomnia. Research endowment. Psychological. Loss of father. Family trauma. Research endowment. Psychological. Reconstruction of trust after loss. Personal apology. Unpracticed. Death of patient in physician's care. Statement of grief. Unpracticed. Death of son. Never mind, Hanu. Buy a few dog hives for a soil reclamation project somewhere. Honeybees, whatever strain is best. And big friendly Newfoundlands for the hives. Everyone loves dog hives. Ongoing projects. Exomind. Blocked. Contact Ishtar Collective on Venus for their trick. Failed. Hire Dwayne McNeve away from Ishtar Collective on Venus. Failed. Raid Ishtar Collective on Venus for data. In planning. Europa / Clarity. In progress. Be a good man and a good grandfather. In progress. Become Luca of future human thought. In progress. Note, Barrow trauma. If we land too hard on Europa, we will plunge into the ocean below the ice and die of Barrow trauma, death by pressure. The only light down there comes from magma and phosphorescent bait. The sea is 10 times deeper than Earth's. Even in Europa's weak gravity, peak pressure at the sea floor is 2,000 atmospheres, worse than Venus before the Traveler. One imagines Pi contracting under that kind of pressure, crushing the perfect circle closed. I wonder what lives down there. What slow confusions of mass and form curl around the smoking vents? What threads of pale flesh slither across dark miles like nerves in some vast cold brain? Did the Traveler bypass Europa and Titan and Enceladus out of respect for their native life? Or was it too afraid to touch the things pulsating below the ice? What we can clearly learn from this first entry in Clovis Bray's journal is that the darkness is something that he's interacted with before in the form of the K1 artifact in the K1 facilities on Luna, and it whispered to him as it whispered to us and as it whispered to Aramis, a lore video that I'll also need to get to. I told him to come to Europa to discover the gift that would be his gateway into immortality, a gift that Clovis would giddily accept and would name Clarity, a gift that we ourselves would discover upon entering the Deepstone Crypt. The other one thing worthy of explanation to you is something that I believe was made fairly clear in the reading, but regardless, it's the fact that Clovis Bray has had a very long life and is even using a stock of genetically modified pigs, the current one of which is called Whitford. It seems like a trivial detail, but Clovis is having his organs constantly replaced. And this is not just based simply on the fact that he himself has had a moment to live so long that he is in a place of terrible decay, but also it is something that speaks to the grander place where he is in the entirety of civilization. And that's where I'm going to go ahead and leave that for now, and hopefully that becomes a lot more clear later down the line. Regardless, he's been able to extend his life to an incredible scale thanks to the use of these genetically modified pigs. The life, however, that Clovis buys with these transplants is only meant to be temporary. His search for clarity is going to lead him to a form of immortality that can only be described as truly revolutionary. But for now, that's where we'll leave our story. Next time, we're going to uncover the secrets of Clovis Bray's family in a bit more depth. And in particular, you're going to understand better those suggestions of Hanu about the various things that Clovis Bray I could gift his granddaughter Elizabeth, and why, for some reason, they all seem to be something medical or something to do with a patient dying in a doctor's care. You're going to understand a lot more about that by the end, and if you do not believe that Clovis is somehow twisted at this moment in time, you are going to see the true depths of everything that the Bray family has done. But with all of that said, that's it from me for now. If you enjoyed the video, go ahead and leave a like, and of course, if you are so inclined and want more Destiny content, go ahead and hit subscribe and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. Also know that you can leave comments on the video if you're so inclined. Tell me what you want to hear about next. I think the next thing that I'm going to do is also start a second, shorter parallel series talking about Aramis and the fallen of the Dark Empire. With all of that said though, know that your viewership is quite enough for me, and in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife. Horodacia ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside. We'll be right back.